Protestant baby for adoption, in need of a good caring home. These words were written on a yellowing piece of paper, tucked away in an old bag belonging to my granny and hidden in a back room. Beside that advert, there were two folded up letters from families looking for a child. I found them that day that I was looking through old bags belonging to my granny. And I know for sure she never meant me to find them. That advertisement, Protestant baby for adoption, was about me. It really broke me to the core that day. And at first, I really couldn't read those words, but I scanned them again and again. And I just wouldn't believe it. So I shoved them deep down into my pocket so that nobody could see, and I ran home. My wife Jo was at home that day, and I asked her to read them again just to make sure that I'd got it right. And together, we made sense out of something that really made no sense to me at all, as we read together, Protestant baby for adoption. It was really hurtful to read that, and it was bad enough being an unwanted child, but to be placed in an advert with motor cars and chickens and washing machines really hurt. The only thing that my parents and family were sure of from the beginning was that they wanted me to be brought up by Protestants. Strange to think that I've ended up with a Catholic. My name is Rowley McIntyre, and I'm very proud of that name, but it could have easily been so different. I was born in 1952 into a Church of Ireland family in the Protestant village of Keish. I came from good Protestant stock, with both orange and black on both family sides. You could say at that time it would have been known as being born out of wedlock. The woman that I knew as my sister actually turned out to be my mother. And that wasn't easy for her or easy for me. I can still remember in the park where I lived, a lady pulling her children away one day and shouting at them, "Come you away! Don't you be playing with that wee fat bastard. At least all you children know who your father is." But I coped, because whilst there were two replies to that advert, my grandmother decided to keep me for her own. She would say to me, "I'm your mother," and I would call her Ma. I would run to her, and she would say, "Don't you worry, son. There'll be love for you in this house." And I was loved. Some people would say spoiled, but that's what kept me going. And Ma would cover me in her caring nature, and that's what protected me. I remember as a young boy, I used to share the room with my mum's sister, Aunt Noel. And in the summer evenings, as I would go to sleep, I would hear the whispering and the curtains moving and the window being pushed open so that she could talk to her boyfriend. My aunt's boyfriend was a Catholic, you know. And if Ma would have known that, I have no doubt she would have scolded him. But it was nothing personal, because at that time, there was trouble too. People were being killed in 1960. You see, violence and loss hardens people. You would have thought by then I would have known all about getting involved in a mixed marriage. Because me and mixed, like my Aunt Noel and her boyfriend, is hushed and hidden about, and mostly in the dark, but not altogether, is done privately behind closed curtains. Everybody knows what's going on, but nobody wants to talk about it. That's why I have thought a few times about some of the decisions I've made. Outside the house, I had to stand up for myself, because hard knocks give me strength. And I remember when I was 16 and at the tech, three young fellas got me in the toilets and they really made a mess of me. They soaked me in the sinks. They put my head down the toilets. They degraded me. They shamed me. And any pride that I had at that time, they stripped it completely away. I remember that day going home on the bus, and I was soaked and devastated. But I knew if I didn't take a stand, my life would be lost. But that was a turning point for me. Something changed that day. Something changed in my whole life. I got a strength. I got a strength that day that will enable me through life to stand up for whatever I believed in, no matter what that was. And that would never happen again to me in my life. I met Joe when I worked as a doorman in the Lough Erne Hotel cache. She came in that night with her friends and paid me a compliment on how well I was looking. I knew Joe was a Catholic, but that didn't really worry me. My confidence at that time wasn't great, but I was hopeful. So later on, I sent her over a drink, and I noticed her looking over a few times. And when she ran out of cigarettes, sure, I bought her 40. And later on that evening, I asked her, could I give her a lift home? So you could say, I sold myself for 40 fags. Well, to be truthful, it was the best money I ever spent. And I was just so happy that such a good-looking girl would even consider coming out with me. But outside our circle, everybody wasn't happy. I received mass cards, and they said, Rowley McIntyre will be remembered at the seven holy masses. I received sympathy cards, and they were full of obscenities, calling me a traitor, and death threats, all because I was going out with somebody of the wrong religion. And this all from supposedly my own kind. People that I knew, people that I grew up with and went to school with and played with as a child. People that I drank with and people that I worked with. And men that I would have lost blood for. All wanting to deal with this friend who they now said had become a Fenian lover. And when I asked them why, all they could say was, oh, you've let the side down. As if I was a member of a football team. Was this not my real life? This wasn't the religion that I had been taught by faithful Sunday school teachers. They had taught me honesty. They had taught me compassion and truth. These people were as far away from Christianity as you would ever want to be. But I hadn't told Joe about this for some time because I didn't want to worry her. And boy, did I remember that day in the toilet when I was soaked and drenched and humiliated, And I knew I would have to stand up and fight to keep her. And if I didn't, they would take away everything I have, everything I love, and everything I care about away from me. I chose to love Joe. So many good in my life, and so many good for my life, no matter what others wanted. And I destroyed those toxic cards. And I let go of the hurt and the pain. And I chose my life. Is that courageous? Maybe. But I know I love Jo. And I wanted to keep her for my own. She was the one for me. That's the way it was, as simple as that. But still we find that mixed love is hidden and hushed. But I want to tell people openly that I love you, and to tell our children and family that what we have built together is something to be proud of.
I'm nobody's child, I'm nobody's child. I'm like a flower just growing wild. If patience is a virtue, then I must be a very virtuous woman, because I'm blessed with patience. The harder a thing is, the more I'll stick at it till I solve it. I'll work happily with a tangled necklace to smooth out every knot. And when frustration comes and others gives up, that's when I get going. That's when I'm at my best. The doctors told me that my baby boy would never walk. No way. Him clinging to his wee brick cart, and me saying, come on, son, come on, you can do it. Stumbling and tripping, one step at a time, he did it. And today, he walks fine. I've had to wait for a lot in life, but I've seen things through by sticking at them. I'm not sure where that comes from. Maybe my mummy. But when I was wee, I got a pea stuck up my nose. But there was no panic. Mommy just got dressed to take me to the doctor's, and I sat and watched her. She put on a beautiful dusky pink blouse, and it had gorgeous, like glass-like buttons down the front of it. And, oh, she smelled beautiful. Oh, how I loved her. There was four of us girls, no boys. And your mummy's always loved the youngest one best, and that was me. And when the bread man would come, and if it was raining, mummy would pull a coat on up over her head and say, come on in under my wing, just like a hen would say to her wee baby chick. And on a Saturday morning, I'd crawl into bed beside her, and we'd listen to the Laughing Policeman song, giggling and laughing, all snuggled up together. I didn't know my mummy was sick until near the end. I was only 13 when I realized that she was dying. She was only 46. My sister and I would sit on her hospital bed, and mummy would say, you can have my wedding ring, or you can have that beautiful brooch of mine that you like. Even then, it didn't fully hit me. There was no smiling or laughing on the bed that day. She died on Valentine's Day. And for years, that's why I thought that I didn't receive any Valentine cards. I waited for Cupid to strike, and it happened after 29 years. On Friday, the 22nd of June, 1984, my Rolly would say that there was a hypnotist on that night and he ended up married. And that's why he's never been back to see one since. The truth is, my sister used to talk about this fella from Cash who had lost a lot of weight. Now, I didn't know him then, but one night I was out sometime later and sure enough, Rolly was there. And I went over to congratulate him on his weight loss. And here the next thing, didn't he send me over a drink from the bar? And that's how it all began. And after only 4 months together, when he asked me to marry him, I knew that this Rolly person was the one for me. You know, I think it was the softness of his hands that caught me. They were like him. They were gentle and kind. I never really thought of Rolly as a Protestant, though I knew he was. I lived in Edirne, and most of the people in my village was all Catholic. I didn't have many Protestant friends. We lived separately. And I never really thought about the difference between us. Maybe because other things were more important. It changed, though, when we decided to get married. The phone call stopped. The invites dried up, and our circle of friends got smaller. I knew enough to be wary, though. I didn't tell my daddy at first. I wasn't sure just what he would say. And when I did tell him, his first words were, "There'd be no Cash Protestant coming near our house." Well, I didn't know what to do because since Mommy had gone, Daddy had become number one in my life. But I did what I do well. I took my time. I met Rolly away from home first, and then he would come to the gate. And eventually I invited him in. That first night, God love him, I think he drove 2 or 3 miles away on out past our house before he had the nerve to come in to meet Daddy. He came in and Rolly said, "Hello." Daddy said, "Pleased to meet you." And he sat with his back to him the whole night watching television. I made Daddy his usual cup of tea. And when the news was over, he got up and with a wee nod of his head towards Rolly said, "Good night to you." And off he went to his bed. It was very traumatic. But I think we were just both glad that Rolly wasn't thrown out. Over time, Daddy mellowed, so I never had to make a choice. It wasn't so much the fact that Rolly was a Protestant. It was more really to do with another man coming into our house and taking over the life that Daddy had, taking away his baby girl. On our wedding day, when I was waiting for the car to come back from the church, oh, poor Daddy was so, so nervous. He had me and all my finery going round, closing windows and making sure that the house was all secured. And then suddenly, all alone, I thought about Mommy again. And I just wished that she was there. I would have loved her to have seen me. I would have just loved to have heard her say, "Look at you, my beautiful daughter." Living with Rolly was lovely. His kindness softened Daddy. And when Daddy became sick, Rolly was able to take over the things that Daddy wasn't fit to do for himself anymore. Like shaving him and dressing him and turning him in the night too, and so, so gently, because he was in pain, and he could have sometimes have lashed out, but I never, ever heard a cross word said between the two of them. Maybe Rolly became like the son Daddy never had, and maybe Daddy became like the father Rolly never had. I was with Rolly that day when he found the adoption adverts. I just wanted to keep hugging him. I wanted to take all his pain away because I loved him. Rolly, I'm just so glad that you weren't adopted, because you wouldn't be the Rolly I know now, my Rolly, and I love you. It's those wee moments, just those wee things, those wee moments when I know he needs me and I need him. That's love. Well, that's what's kept us going. The early years changed him, maybe us both. We were unsure of who to trust. In the 80s, Rolly worked in Belfast, and three community workers in his line of work had been killed. And people like us were being tarred and feathered. I didn't know what to do, because we were mixed and we were defenceless. But in the country, things didn't seem as bad. It was more the intimidation factor rather than any actual physical hurt. Many's the night we were followed home in the car, even with a baby in the back of the car, barely a year old. And when we'd indicate, they would. And if we'd speed up or slow down, they would too. And at one point, when they drove up so close behind us, almost touching the bumper of our car, now I couldn't see who they were. Boy, I was scared. I was afraid that they would take Rolly out of the car, maybe and kill him. We were so afraid we couldn't even go into our own home that night, because we were doing some terrible things to people in those days.